A few years ago, the European Commission unveiled a circular economy package, and that really has been hailed as the ambitious driver of this thinking around a circular economy. The Helen MacArthur Foundation is certainly doing a lot there in that space as well. A few years ago, we had the first ever Circular Economy Week take place in London. So it's a conversation that's been happening for some time. It's yet really to show up in any demonstrable way in South Africa. And the question remains as to why and when we're really going to see some major strides forward, as we have seen in Europe. So with that, I'd like to invite Nikki van Hill of the Moss Group up to join this roundtable. Nikki's vision is to be a key driver of systemic and sustainable change within Southern Africa. She established the Moss Group in 2005 in order to achieve this vision. Long-term social, economic, and environmental sustainability really at the heart of all of the strategies, Nikki, that you develop with over two decades' experience as well. Please take a seat. And I'd also like to invite Sally Ann Kastner of Circular Vision, which is a circular economy strategy and design consultancy, someone who's also very passionate about the space. And she's previously an executive associate at JG Africa, which is an engineering and environmental consultancy. So bringing some of that experience with her. So a warm round of applause, everyone, to our panelists today. Nikki, I'll start with you. And some research that was recently conducted in South Africa concerning consumer perceptions around plastic. Can you just expand on that and comment around how consumer perceptions around plastic are evolving to the earlier points that Andrew Fenter made and where you see them in that continuum of starting to connect those dots through to climate change?
Thanks very much. Just to be clear, the research that we did was actually on single-use plastics, because that is the topic that everybody hears. You hear Cape Town's banning single-use plastics. Various retailers put their hands up and say, we're going to have no single-use plastics in our value chain by 2022. So the research was actually into that perception, trying to understand what people think about single-use plastics. First of all, what are they? Mm. Very interesting. Nobody knows. There is such a range of what people define as single-use plastics that it really blew our mind when we actually saw the results. And the research spanned various LSMs, various age groups, people in the industry, people outside of the industry, and there's absolutely no agreement on what single-use plastics actually are. But what did come out really, really strongly is it's a highly emotive area. And it's exactly what Andrew was saying earlier. It is on the top of everybody's mind. One of the amazing stats that came out of it was that about 70% of people think that single-use plastics is the biggest polluter in the world. Now, I don't know how big it is. Nobody really knows the quantum, but that number just blew my mind. Almost everybody who answered the research said they have an opinion. They believe we need to resolve things. But what scared us as well was that the significant number of people that said, just ban them. Government must ban them. But when they don't know what the definition of those things are, it's very hard to say, well, what should you ban? Is it a straw? Is it a plastic fork? When you go through the research, many of them refer to single-use plastics as things that can actually be reused for alternative purposes. So we asked them, do you think a yogurt tub, we gave them a range of about 10 or 15 items, do you think a 1 liter polypropylene yogurt tub is single-use plastic? Significant portion said yes. It's recyclable, it is reusable, but it's not necessarily reusable to put yogurt back into. Mm. So exactly what Andrew was talking about, it's that perception around what this thing is and the conversations around it that get louder and louder. And what is very clear from the research is that the voices that get heard are those who shout loudest, mm. not necessarily those who have the information. And it's social media. It's all over that. It's wherever you look. It's people advertising, putting up comments. We've all seen some claims on various plastic bags this week. Around things that, you know, it gets everybody excited and wanting to do something, But or wanting somebody else to do something, I think that was the big thing from the research as well, is how many people, A, see it as a problem. Yes, it's a critical issue. It's a massive contributor to global pollution. I think it should be banned outright. Do you do anything? Maybe a little bit in my own right, not very many. Do you encourage others to do anything? Very few. So it's a, I'm not going to do it. The retailer, the brand owner, the value chain must do it for me. And if they won't do it, I'm going to government and government must ban it. So that, in a nutshell.
Fascinating. Where can someone get hold of the research if they want to have a look at it themselves?
We're in the process of writing it up. It is still in the process of being finally analyzed and put together, but we'll make it available on our website and share it with the industry.
Because I think that becomes a key part of the conversation to help guide the conversation towards evidence-based policymaking, what I said right up front, to get those definitions clarified and to understand what it is we're talking about, and then move from there to a possible solution. Sally Ann, what do you make of that?
Yeah, I mean, I see it every day as well, in terms of everyone wants to put it onto somebody else to do it. It's not my responsibility. Government must put in legislation or policy without actually realizing what kind of implications that could have. We already have amazing legislation in South Africa currently. It's just not very well enforced. So I think it's really important for all of us sitting in the room, and it has been mentioned today, so I think a lot of what some of the things we're going to say will be echoed, is to say that actually each of us need to take responsibility. It's up to everybody along the value chain to accept a portion of this. If we don't, it's too easy to pass the blame. So we really need to, if we don't do that, so if we don't all start speaking to each other, generally what's been happening over the time is we'll put materials onto the marketplace and then recyclers must find a solution for it. So I'm not sure who else are recyclers in the room, but essentially it's not up to the recyclers to find a solution for it. We must design, not for recycling, but we must design for next use. Not even end of life. I think we must stop talking about end of life. We need to start talking about next use. So when we're designing this packaging, make it fit for purpose. Make it do the job we need it to do, but make sure that there's a value attached to it so we can get that material back. And I'm really keen to see how the chemical industry or the resin producers can be involved in ensuring that those materials come back.
What do you see as a big opportunity to stay on that point for the resin producers?
The big opportunity, and I'm not a chemical engineer, so the guys sitting in the room who are chemical engineers, I think that you've already got huge amounts invested in infrastructure. Surely that infrastructure already, I don't think we need to redesign plants. Maybe there needs to be some redesign, but surely we can use what's existing in order to design materials appropriately that we can actually put them back into those plants. Again, I'm not a chemical engineer, but can that be done? And is that maybe part of the question, is how do we challenge ourselves to think differently?
I can see Craig already thinking about exactly how they might be able to do that. So if you and Nikki, to go back to your point about everyone saying, well, not in my backyard and passing the buck, who is going to do what about it here? Because we can't just continue with this business as usual situation. Mm-hmm. Who's going to do what?
I think it comes back to what Sally Ann said. Everyone needs to do something. But I think what's happened, to build on what Sally Ann was saying just now, is up until now, and I see it in every industry I work in, each piece of the value chain works largely in isolation of the next piece of the value chain, and certainly in isolation of three people up the value chain. And what we believe should be happening is people need to be working together. And that's where I think things like the SA Initiative, the Pact, all of these various activities need to be bringing stakeholders across the value chain to talk and actually establish solutions, understand from a consumer perspective what consumer problem are we trying to resolve with a particular packaging? Why are we putting it in something in the first place? Then working backwards, but together with the full value chain, including, and it's not just the virgin producers, it's the recyclers, it's the waste collectors, it's all of that, it's government. So it's a what we like to call an integrated supply chain, people working far more closely together, all towards meeting an end goal.
And it reminds me of a story that I came across towards the back end of last year, I think, where Nestle had been working on a confectionery wrapper that was biodegradable and decided to release that intellectual property to the broader market to say, right, the problem is bigger than us, and so this is almost like a pre-competitive collaborative solution. And that sounded to me, just as a layperson here, so forgive me if I'm wrong, as a really sensible solution to this, as an example. Now, I don't want to get distracted by that. We're here talking about the circular economy. Is it achievable? There seems to be some cynicism as to whether or not we can realistically create a circular economy. And Sally Ann, I mean, that's really your field of expertise. Is this possible? Is it some holy grail? Is it worth just aspiring to it but saying we'll probably never get there?
Definitely it is something that we can get to, without a doubt. But it does mean that we need to shift our thinking quite radically. And that's uncomfortable. It might mean we have to relook at some of the business models in terms of more reuse, more refill, more reverse logistics. Very different scenarios than what we're comfortable with right now. So, and that might even need to go up even one level, saying as an industry, perhaps there are certain products that are currently being put out that might be suitable in a different packaging type. I'm not saying that it is, but I'm just saying we need to be bold enough to actually say, you know what, actually we can rethink this by using a different material completely in order to have a more closed loop look at something. So I'm just wondering, how can we, with the Global Alliance and the Pact, we'll look at packaging more as integrated and a more fit for purpose design, and not only look at the material and say, my material is better than yours. How do we actually look at what it's trying to deliver instead? And I think that's what the core is to circular economy, is looking at fit for purpose, looking at regeneration, building resilience into the system. And how do we get material that's more responsibly sourced? So in terms of trying to keep those materials in the system for longer. How do we optimize for efficiency and energy using renewable energies? I'm not sure how many industries are looking at, obviously, the different potential of renewable energies. Putting materials into the marketplace that are non-toxic, I think are, for me, radically important, especially with some of the end uses that are maybe being put out there, perhaps aren't the best longer term. So yeah, a personal example, and I'm still researching, but so plastic timber for me is potentially one that I'd like to know a little bit more about in terms of how it behaves. We use a lot of materials that we can't recycle into plastic timber because it's a solution. And I think the intention is good. But is it the best solution? Is it the best application to use in a children's playground in the baking sun when we're not really sure exactly what's coming into these materials as an input source? So I'm digressing slightly, but I think when we're talking about the circular economy, we need to design, like I mentioned, with next use in mind and keep the materials in the cycle for as long as possible at their highest utility and grade for as long as possible.
I hear what you're saying. Allow me to be a little bit controversial, but it does look like the economics are driving the outcome here more than thinking beyond that and trying to do things differently. What needs to happen for that paradigm shift to finally lead to business models changing and this kind of circular economic thinking to take root?
I think for me, personally, being in the waste industry, is just taking a look at our current landfill space. Okay, we don't even have to look at the marine environment. We know, and we've seen from the presentations this morning, that we know there's lots of ocean litter and plastic in the oceans. But if you actually go to a landfill site, how many of you have been to a landfill site? Great, quite a few. And the periphery of the landfill site, as we mentioned this morning as well, keeping stuff in a landfill site is quite difficult. Basically, our landfills in South Africa are running out. I think for me, that is the next crisis, and that will definitely push. We're already seeing a bigger push from government saying we've actually got to do something. We've got to minimize, we've got to divert. In the Western Cape, we've got an organic waste ban. So 50% by 2022 and 100% by 2027, organic waste cannot go to landfill anymore. So the thing is, I think we're going to be pushed in a certain direction purely because of crisis. It's not going to be,
Nikki?
I'd like to build on that as well, because I think crisis always leads to change. It would be very nice if the human race didn't rely on crises. And I think those organizations that are forward-thinking enough to look for the innovation in their business models now, and I'm going to echo what Andrew said earlier, if you're beholden to your current business model now and you think that it's going to survive for the next 15, 20 years, I will not put my money anywhere near you, and I hope to hang my pension fund money isn't going into your organization either. But I think it is about being bold and looking at what are you there for as an organization? Why do you exist? It's that purpose-driven strategy that we hear Simon Sinek's been talking about for a long time. But I've seen the power of that shift change in large organizations where really starting to go back to basics and fundamentally rethinking who you are. And that starts to create and open opportunities for new business. So it's not about my business is threatened. It's about where is my business opportunity in the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. So yes, use the crises, but try and be proactive around seeing the opportunity.
And we've got more than enough of those around the country at the moment to start stimulating some positive change in the economy. But Bobby Godsell used to love to say about South Africans, we've got this propensity to walk up to the edge of the precipice, have a good look over, but then pull ourselves back from it. And one does get a sense that in a dialogue like this, that is one of those moments. When it comes to biodegradable plastics as a solution, I was chatting to Prof. Linda Godfrey of the Waste Roadmap on my show last night about this, and we need to be very careful here because there are all sorts of unintended consequences to what on the surface looks like a very emotively good solution. What is your view on biodegradable plastics as a solution?
So I think there is a place for these plastics. But the challenge is, it's where do we use them? It comes back to Sally Ann's fit for purpose. If we're going to do a natural switch out with things that are already in strong recycling streams, already have mechanisms for collection, going back into a process that takes them out of the environment, then it's not, in my opinion, particularly applicable. We need to be looking at these things. There are a lot of them on the market. They're getting stronger and stronger because they talk to that consumer argument of wanting a solution. But what we've got to be very, very careful of, and I think the biggest unintended consequence is, again, consumers, because that's where it ends up, believing that these things disappear overnight. So it says biodegradable or it says compostable, leave it on the side of the road, leave it in the forest, and woomph, it's gone. It doesn't work like that. As we have with plastics, traditional plastics, we need to set up collection infrastructure. We need to set up the infrastructure to process the stuff in industrial composting facilities the way they were designed to do. So yes, I think they have a role. I think what would be very dangerous is if the traditional polymer and plastics industry were to say, we don't want you, and we don't want to play nicely with you. As much as for that side of the industry to say, we don't want to play with the traditional plastics. I think it is about working together, and it comes back to that collaborative thing, about looking for space together, very uncomfortable. I understand that. But if we can get the two sides of the space to play together, I think we can actually come up with solutions.
Sally Ann, what are the challenges here? Because I've had it put to me that if you introduce biodegradable plastics, they could then contaminate the traditional recycling stream, and you can't have pipes that are made out of recyclable plastic biodegrading in the ground. I mean, it's a very real concern.
So I'm almost thinking that we need to change the wording and the terms that we use, because the biodegradables, they're not like for like. In fact, I almost think that the biodegradable side of it, we should actually just stop using the word completely and talk about compostable, if something is really compostable. Because essentially some of the biodegradables that are out there, that it's normal HDPE with an additive in. And what are we creating? We're creating other problems in the system. So it's not a direct swap out. And this is why I think what Nikki's saying, we've got to work collaboratively with this. Because I think that there's a super opportunity to look at potentially compostables to assist with organic waste and getting organic waste out of the system to stimulate new economies for these composting facilities that we need. Do you know how much fertilizer we import into South Africa every year? chemical fertilizer. Okay, I'm sorry if some of you guys are chemical fertilizers. Sorry. But over 300,000 tons. Okay, that's a lot. What if, do you know how much, I just want to get my figures straight here, because we've got about 2.4 million tons of unavoidable, inedible portion of food waste in South Africa every year that's going to waste. What if we could use these compostables to get this waste safely out in order to create and build our soil again? At the moment, we are facing food security issues as well. Our soils are being depleted. How do we build the soil if we're not putting stuff back in, but we just keep taking? So for me, I think there's a really cool opportunity for potentially, and this is how some of the international guys have seen it, they were traditionally only petrochemical-based companies that have shifted part of their business into this compostable space, not biodegradable. We're not taking plastic and adding some miracle additive to make it disappear over unspecified time. We're actually going to make a material that is fit for purpose to get organic waste out of the stream. But yeah.
I want to move it on now to who really takes ownership and who in the value chain is responsible for the manufacture of responsible plastic packaging. Because this is one of those issues, Nikki, if you look at it, it does seem to be banned. You know, the brand owner will point at the consumer. The manufacturer will then point at the brand owner and say, well, that's what they're asking for. And everyone seems to pass the buck here. Where does that buck eventually stop?
It's a very difficult question. And it's a case of, I think, all responsible businesses across the value chain actually need to have responsibility for, so producers right from the beginning all the way through to end use. And in fact, we had a workshop with the biodegradable and compostable importers and manufacturers 2 weeks ago. And there was a big debate about a particular compostable shopping bag that is on the market that was put out by a retailer with it's non-compliant in terms of its labeling. And the big debate was who's responsible for that. And it started out with a conversation of it's that retailer's problem. But the end of the conversation realized actually it's not. It's the resin importers' problem as much as it is the converters, as much as it is the retailers. Because when something gets out into the market that is irresponsible, yes, the retailer is going to get slammed or the brand owner is going to get slammed, but equally, the producer of that material ultimately is going to take flak. So it actually, again, it comes back to the closer we work together, the more the value chain participates together and takes responsibility, the better chance we have of success.
Interesting question on Slido and to the earlier point about the retailers that Craig made. They're notably absent from the conversation largely, and this is not a South African issue, it's a global phenomenon. Why is it so difficult?
Can I comment? Thank you. In South Africa, the retailers are participating actively. So in the SA initiative, in the Plastic Pact, they are visibly there. All the big, many of the big retailers are actively participating. And I think it's because they do realize that they have a very, very big role to play. Mm. And they were actually, interestingly, they were largely absent in the conversations until the IWMP call, the Integrated Waste Management Plan call, came a few years ago. And they started realizing they might become liable for levies and things like that on their imported products. They are brand owners. As much, they all own house brands, every single one of them. So that got them to wake up.
Sally Ann, I see you nodding your head in agreement there. But I perhaps want to take this one step further as well and just bring it back to the budget recently and the increase in the plastic bag levy. There's a lot of debate. Treasury admitted as much they're going to be reviewing the levy as to whether or not, and we know Treasury's take is you don't ring fence levies for a specific purpose. It doesn't work that way. But whether the levy is having the intended impact. It certainly doesn't look that way, just from a personal shopping perspective. When you go to a retailer, everyone's still walking out with plastic bags. It's obviously raising a nice chunk of revenue for Treasury. But if the intended purpose is to shift behavior, then it's very difficult to argue that it's being very effectively used. So what should we, how should we be thinking about this plastic bag levy? Should we just accept that it's not going to change behavior, but insist that we use that money to then at least go into research around recycling and waste management? How should we think about this?
Next question. but to my own personal point of view and just some of the interaction, even the levy now, which is now I think 25 cents, is still probably not going to shift behavior to that extent, to be honest. Even speaking to some people in the more informal areas, they say when we go to the shop, we buy a plastic bag. It's only 60 cents, rand even, and that's fine because I need to carry my shopping home and then I use the bag when I get home. So I think it's not the simple answer is that it's not a simple answer. It's actually quite a complex issue, and I think we definitely need to talk more around it to understand what are the different options that we can supply, and then what are the different financial mechanisms that we can put in place, because that money is going to Treasury. We can't get it out. If anybody else knows how to get it out, please let us know, because it's not going to come out. So I think what the minister's now doing in terms of the Section 18 EPR plans are definitely the better way of looking at this and getting us all around the table and looking at those extended producer responsibility fees that we can pay through a PRO to actually get action and movement in this space. Because we're not going to get it from the plastic bag tax.
I believe there is even talk or consideration of extending the levy to other single-use plastics. Again, how do we define those, Nikki? Mm. Straws?
Exactly.
So that becomes a key challenge.
And I think one of the other things that we really need to realize, and I think I was very glad that Peter Ryan presented it earlier this morning, the HDPE insights. Making decisions to get rid of a particular thing when you do not understand the full context in which it is being used and what is happening to it across that value chain is very dangerous. So plastic bags, you know, plastic carrier shopping bags are not, most people will classify them as single use, but they get reused multiple times by many, many, many people. Now, if you take that out, what is the alternative? Mm. Do people then go to the aisle where all the other plastic bags are being sold and buy a bag of plastic bags to line their dustbins, to pick up their dog poo, to carry their lunch in, to carry their whatever in that they're taking to work. So I think it's a much bigger, much more complex question than just saying ban the bag or put up a 50 cents, one rand levy on it.
But back to the perception issue. I mean, people view paper and glass as environmentally friendly. They don't view, into the research that you've done, plastic as environmentally friendly. Why do you sense this is, based on your research? And is that the correct perception?
Definitely is the perception out there. And it's not just consumers. I deal with many, many brand owners, many retailers, very much the immediate jump. And it's going down the line that Andrew mentioned this morning. It's the non-renewable nature of it. There's definitely a jump that people are making that plastic is made of a non-renewable resource, whereas paper, well, it's made from a tree. I can grow it. They don't necessarily know, when, particularly if you're talking about paper, packaging, they don't necessarily know that tree's not grown in South Africa. It may very well be grown in Europe and processed there and shipped to South Africa. Glass, they don't necessarily know how it's made or where it's from, but they've got a sense that it comes from sand and there's lots of that stuff and, you know, it's not as bad and there's always been a lot of recycling going on, so it must be good. So I think it comes back to that lack of knowledge and perceptions around just it's better than because it's renewable or it's not fossil fuel based.
So I would actually put a lot of emphasis on the marketing of these products as well, because often people will actually put... Remember when the BMW and Mercedes-Benz, they had the advert, BMW brought one out saying BMW beats the Benz? Mm. It's kind of a similar thing that's going on with packaging, where, you know, you'll have your competitors going out, they're saying paper's better for the environment, or this is better for the environment, or even within the plastic space, sometimes it's going, you know, this type of plastic material is better than. So marketing doesn't help. We actually need to put the right messaging out there Because consumers take the headlines, can't remember which speaker it was now, I think it was Andrew as well, that put it out there, that they don't go deeper than the headlines. And it's absolutely true. There's so much going on right now, all you want to read is the headline. And people have also stopped asking questions. So if you don't actually give them the right information right at the top, it's not going to go any deeper than that. So yeah, I think it's very important, the marketing and messaging behind it.
I just having a look at the Slido question here, the economics of the value chain prior to getting to a recycler is challenging. What options do you see to overcome this? That's a difficult one.
It is a difficult one, but it's also with the same thinking that got us here. So what I'm suggesting is maybe the current value chain economics, yes, but maybe if we completely shifted it around, it might not be at all. It might be a brilliant business model and we just haven't gotten there yet. But it means that we have to completely unpack our current comfortable stance of where we are in this field. We can't, I don't think, only think about getting the coal out the ground and then processing it and, you know, producing the product. We've actually got to think deeper than that. How we want to get a product to the market. How are we going to do that differently? And that's a fundamental shift. So it's not a straight economics argument that I can give you an answer for. It's something that we really do need to pull apart, because that's what the circular economy is all about. It's not about, okay, cool, we'll just tweak this or tweak that and we're fine. It's a fundamental rethink.
And also how we brand things. Nikki, I mean, if you just think of the name recycled paints versus eco-friendly paints.
Yeah.
And how that resonates with the consumer, it's fundamentally the same thing, but a completely different message to market.
Absolutely, and I think that is where, exactly to your point, the marketing's getting in, is confusing consumers. And if anybody sticks, they can win by putting it's environmentally friendly, it's greener than, with not necessarily having the evidence behind it. Trick is, how do we use that marketing power? Because brand owners and retailers are the best people at getting us to do things we probably wouldn't normally do. So how do we get their power harnessed to get them to get us to do what we should be doing?
Big question, but an important part of the broader solution. Do we have, and I mentioned the point earlier to Peter Ryan, he said, no, I'm really an ornithologist who's barefoot on beaches looking at these things. Do we have South African data on the carbon footprint of plastic and paper and glass and the various packaging materials? Are we working on that? Who takes the lead here? How is it funded? That kind of thing. Sally-Anne?
So I'm going to say yes and no, because there have been many studies that have been done on these various things. But it all depends on how the study has been conducted. So a better approach would be not only just to consider carbon, but maybe including the water and waste cycle into these assessments. And ecological footprinting has been included as maybe a better metric, but also full life cycle assessment. So looking at cradle to hopefully cradle, okay, as opposed to cradle to grave, as it used to be. So cradle to cradle. But what happens is, I'll give you an example. Many years ago, there was a particular washing powder that had put out their new multi-layer packaging with a tree on it, tree logo, and on there it said, better for the environment than a cardboard box. So with further detail digging, I found that actually, no, an LCA was conducted. That's a life cycle assessment. It's like, great, that's fabulous news. He said, can you tell me a bit more? No, it was just done from cradle to gate. So basically, from source to when they sold the product, then they didn't care about it anymore. So the thing is, when we do these types of assessments, you've got to really understand what's behind it and what they have included and what they haven't included. So that's why it's fundamental. We actually have to ask questions constantly. We've just stopped asking questions. We say, oh, no, it's cool. That's better for the environment than a cardboard box. I'm just saying that it to be, you know, a little bit that... You know, these things are out there. There is information. You will, if you Google life cycle assessment or carbon footprint of a PET bottle or of anything, you'll probably find something. But whether it's right or wrong.
Nikki?
And I think the other part of LCN, it's the natural go-to is carbon footprint. And I think you touched on it, but I think where the methodology around life cycle assessment is actually moving is what they call LCSAs, life cycle sustainability assessments. And that is looking at environmental metrics, not just carbon footprint. Mm-hmm. So it's water usage, mm-hmm. it's eutrophication, it's all of those things. I can't list them, but there's probably about 7 or 8 metrics that people tend to use. There's also social impacts, mm-hmm. because we have to make trade-offs. It's a sad reality, but what are those social metrics? So we make a shift in the value chain. What happens to waste pickers, for example? And how does that potentially undermine or change that system? If you haven't done that work, the economics as well. So it's looking at environmental, social, and economic activities when you're doing a comparison. Mm-hmm. And it's about looking beyond just what's in front of you. It's that bigger picture.
Yeah, being bold, and that's back to the circular economy, this kind of take, make, dispose mentality mm-hmm. has to change. Mm-hmm. And very much aligned with the kind of nexus thinking, water, energy, food nexus, and how all of those are interrelated. So, if we're wrapping, and there is that lovely word again, no pun intended, if we're wrapping this all together, putting a bow on it, what do we need to do? Once we've taken a lot of these described initiatives and we know exactly what the carbon footprints of all of these things are, what else do we need to do? Then what are the next steps?
I'll go first, purely because I just think that, like anything, you've actually got to remain relevant. You've got to constantly evolve. You can't just say, cool, we've done this, tick the box, we can move on. You've actually just got to constantly evolve and shift. And essentially, I mean, if I'll give you 2 examples, just Kodak and Nokia. They were leaders of their industry at the time. Said, cool, we've done what we've needed to do. We are top of our game. And they just got taken out. And I think as an industry, this is such an opportunity to say, how do we stay relevant and how do we stay and be part of the change? I think for me, that's quite exciting from a plastics perspective. How do we fundamentally be part of this shift, which might mean a change in business, might mean a change or partnership with another material. Yeah.
Nikki?
I think there's so much to be done. It's almost, where do we start? You've got to eat the elephant one bite at a time. So I think there's a lot that's already going on, and I see it evolving into, and I see it, and it's not just in the sector, I see it in many, many sectors that I work in, where it's moving towards a more collaborative way of working and shifting our way from being competitors. So Dow, Sasol, and Safripol not being in the same room. I'm being silly. You are. But it's moving away from those conversations and saying, actually, we can participate and we need to rethink our world together, your point about Nestlé. Mm. But I think that's where the evolution's coming. Mm. It's a very different way of thinking because it requires a totally different way of being, a level of trust that we're not naturally used to. And I think that's where some of these initiatives, I think, are starting the ball rolling. It's getting people in the same room, talking in an uncomfortable position and hopefully shifting behavior.
Yeah, which has certainly been echoed throughout the day. Are you seeing successes, Sally Ann, of this personally in your consulting work and the businesses and organizations you interact with?
Definitely. There's definitely a more of a collaborative advantage to working together. So, another organization I represent is the African Circular Economy Network. And that, somebody, I think you were mentioning that, you know, has circular economy really started taking off? It's not really landed yet in Africa. It actually has. And in Africa, we've got this amazing ability in many of our more traditional communities. Circular economy is just what is done. You know, that's just how things, you know, that we work with the nature cycles, right? As we rapidly urbanize and the population increases, that puts a lot more pressure on it. But I think in our African economies, the opportunities are there. Circular economy is definitely high up on the agenda. Even our government has formed the African Alliance for Circular Economy, and we're leading it. That's in with Rwanda and there are 4 other countries, which I can't remember right now. But essentially, so our government is taking it seriously from a governmental and African Union perspective, as well as the private industry across the African continent is taking it seriously, and we're working together to see how we can actually implement and have action on the ground. And that's by connecting dots. So pulling the strings together, hopefully.
Yeah. And just to build on that, and we've got technologies that have fundamentally shifted business models all over the hackneyed examples are Uber and Airbnb and these asset-light businesses, but they are fundamentally changing the way we use assets like motor cars, for example, in the future, which you buy, it sits in the garage for 5% of the time, and then it kind of gets old and decrepit and maybe goes to another country and sold there, and then eventually it ends up in a heap. Uber's fundamentally changing that, and electric vehicles will change that. How do you see the app and digital economy driving this change to a circular model?
So a really interesting case study that I've learned more recently. It's a local young startup, a mechanical engineer that basically did his MBA and saw a need for developing a recycling initiative within a community that generally didn't have access. And he developed an app. So it's an app-based system. It's like an Uber system for recyclables. So as a community member, you join up to the app. You let them know when you need your collection done. And you hand in to your collection to a collector, which is on a bicycle with a cage type system. So you're implying he's actually using waste pickers from that particular area who are now using these bicycles to collect. And when you've handed in, yes, it's an incentive program. So depending on how much you provide or hand in, you get grocery app or a grocery voucher or airtime app or some airtime voucher. I'm losing my words. So it's actually quite a nice. It's still in its pilot phase, but it's dealing on that kind of using technology and trying to solve a localized problem. Obviously, more international case studies like Loop, which is using reusable packaging. I'm sure many of you know about Loop. It's also a really nice story, started up by a waste company. So they traditionally changed their business model from being a waste management company to providing a reusable packaging service in partnership with big brands like Procter & Gamble, Unilever, Haagen-Dazs ice cream are the ones that come to mind first, but there are quite a few others. And I mean, so those types of things are happening. And one more example. In South America, a company called Algramo is actually, somebody mentioned, I think it was Anabi, sachets of washing powder for single-use washing. They now have mobile units going into villages, more rural villages, where they will dispense into whatever container you have for that particular amount for your washing. So it does away with the packaging. So that's a very different business model, and it's working in that particular community. Whether these things are completely replicable anywhere else, I think we need to look at our situation here and what could or couldn't work. So I think the opportunities are absolutely endless. You've really just got to open the mind.
Back to my earlier thought experiment of smacking people on the back of the head. On that note, we've reached the end of this round table. So Sally Ann and Nikki, warm round of applause, everyone. Thank you very much for getting us to think a little bit differently.